Okay, so now let's move on to the discussion on galvanic cells. So a galvanic cell is basically an electrochemical cell where you have a spontaneous redox reaction occurring. And in here, you have two beakers. So you have, on one beaker, you have the oxidation, and on the other side is the reduction. So this is a reaction whereas reactants are separated. The one that undergoes oxidation is on a different location than the one that undergoes reduction. So we are separating the changes. We are separating the reactants, the one the oxidants and the reductants. Now, we call the part that is being oxidized or the part of the galvanic cell that undergoes oxidation is the anode, and the part that undergoes reduction is the cathode. Now, how does this reaction becomes complete? So you have your basically a current. This is the anode, the oxidation, and this is the cathode for the reduction. Now, how the heck are they reacting? So they are reacting through the connections of the wire. So you have a wire. The movement of the electron comes from the anode towards the cathode because it's the one that is being oxidized. So zinc is losing the electron, and that electron is moving to the copper. So this is the one being reduced. So the galvanic cell produces a current that is actually measured, that can be measured. So that's how it becomes an electrochemical cell. You can actually create current here, and that is the principle of a battery. So we have, how does this current go, or why are they reacting? How does it work basically? So you have what you call an electromotive force or a cell voltage. So that's the difference in an electrical potential between the anode and cathode. So some people call it cell voltage because the unit for that is the volts. A more formal way to talk about that is the electromotive force, because it's the force that moves electrons. That's why it's called electromotive. Or sometimes it's called cell potential, the potential of the cell to react. So for example, here is the zinc and the copper. So the zinc is being oxidized and the copper is being reduced. So in this particular reaction, the concentration, when you see a bracket, that means it's a concentration units. The concentration of copper is 1 molar and the concentration of zinc is 1 molar. So if you're going to write them in a cell diagram, this is how it would look like. So the anode part, the one that is oxidized, is written first. So you have the zinc to zinc two plus. So that is the reactant, is the product. And then the other side, you have the cathode. This is the reactant, this is the product. So copper two plus to copper solid. So that is your anode and cathode reaction. And then in the middle, you have what we call the phase boundary or the salt bridge. So as you can see here, we have a line separating, a vertical line separating the reactant and the product in the anode side, and the same goes for the cathode side. And then to separate the anode from the cathode, you have a double vertical line. So the standard reduction potential is, in we usually call it E naught, E raised to zero. So it's standard reduction potential. So reduction potential per se is usually given as a capital E, but if it's a standard reduction potential, it has a superscript of zero. So that means it occurs at a standard condition. So a standard condition is 1 molar and 1 atm pressure. So this is your standard hydrogen electrode that's used to actually measure the standard reduction potential of metals, and that is actually a measured value. We know the standard reduction potential. This is a constant for the metal at standard conditions. So, for example, let's see here. You have the zinc, so 1 molar of zinc sulfate and 1 molar of hydrochloric acid. So this one produces a current of 0.76 volts. So when this one reacts, of course, the electrons from the zinc moves on to the hydrogen, so it produces hydrogen gas. So the conditions here is standard condition, that's 1 molar of each reactants, and you have a hydrogen gas at 1 atm. Now, the measured potential here is 0.76, so that's the amount of current that is passing through. Why do we have a current? Because again, the electrons from your anode goes to the cathode. Why does that happen? Because zinc is being oxidized and the hydrogen is being reduced. So, of course, there's a transfer of electron. And the electron is a moving charge, so it produces a current. And that current produces a voltage, and that voltage is measured as 0.76 volts. So this is consistent for zinc at this condition. So all other, that means every time you have a setup like this at this particular condition, so 1 molar and 1 atm, you will always get 0.76 volts. So that is your standard reduction potential. So anode undergoes oxidation, the other one goes reduction. So the reaction here is, again, I'm missing my arrows, but this is a zinc to hydrogen gas. You have the arrow here. You have zinc 2 plus to H2 at 1 atm. So this is the, we call it the standard EMF or standard electromotive force, standard reduction potential as 0.76 volts. So that is the total standard reduction potential of the cell. Now, how do you know the potential of each particular reactant, the cathode and the anode? So in here, we have an arbitrary value, that is, we peg the reduction potential of the hydrogen. This is the standard hydrogen electron, must always be at zero. So that is the reference point that we have. And from that reference point, we calculated all the other standard reduction. That's why you had a table of standard reduction potential. This calculated from the from this setup where we peg the hydrogen electrode, this hydrogen electrode as zero. So that means 0.76 is the E cell. That is E cathode minus E anode. That's always like that. E cathode minus E anode. That is, since this is zero, and the zinc is where we can now get the standard potential of your zinc in the anode side. So that is 0 minus E, that's equal to 76. So you have the zinc, standard deduction potential of the zinc itself as negative 0.76. So that's for the zinc. So this is another setup. This is for copper. This another metal, so still you have the standard hydrogen electrode. In this case, you are generating 0.34 volts. But this is for the cell. The one that's measured by the voltmeter is the E cell. The voltmeter always measures the E cell. So to get the standard reduction potential of copper, you get from the E cell, this is E cathode minus E anode. So that is the reaction here. In this case, unlike the zinc, your hydrogen electrode is the one that is being oxidized. So this is the anode, and then this is the cathode. So for copper, this is equal to positive 0.34. So E copper is 0.34 because, again, the anode side is zero. So E cell is the one that is for the whole reaction. So let's have... So this is basically how this table is generated. So I uploaded a table in your Blackboard. I think it's in the announcement. No, it's in the folder. There's a table of standard deduction potential. You will be using that for your exam. So this is your this is the values for each of them. So this is a partial table. The table that I added in the is more complete. So this is the standard reduction potential for each half reaction. So this is, they can be anode or cathode depending on the setup, but these are the values of their standard reduction potential. So that means the more positive EO, the greater the tendency for the substance to be reduced, and the half cell reactions are reversible. So when the reaction is reversed, the sign is reversed. But anyway, as you can see here, you have your increasing strength of a reducing agent going down. So that means in a spontaneous reaction, for example, you have here lithium as the one at the bottom. That means lithium has the greatest tendency to be reduced. So if you're going to react sodium and lithium, the one that's being reduced here, or the one that is acting as the reducing agent, sorry, that's not the one that's being used. I mean, the one that is acting as a reducing agent is the lithium. That means the lithium is the one that is being oxidized. Oh, by the way, I want to clarify regarding this one. In our electrochemical cell, you have a reducing agent and an oxidizing agent. Now, this is where people are usually becomes confused, because the reducing agent in an electrochemical cell is the one that is being oxidized. Why is it backwards, or rather, why is it the other way around? Why is it not the other way around? The reason is because when you say a reducing agent, that's the agent that is causing the reduction, and the one that is causing the other side to be reduced is basically the one that is being oxidized. So basically, it's a bit of a leap in a bit of how should I say? It's a counterintuitive reasoning, but the rule basically here is if there are, for example, let's say the agent of change. Let's have an analogy. The agent of change. The agent of change is not necessarily be the one that is changing, but it should be the one that is causing the change. So the same goes for the reducing agent. The reducing agent is the one that is not it's not being reduced, but that is the one that is causing the reduction. So that means in a redox reaction, you're either the oxidant or the you're either being oxidized or you're either being reduced. So if you're not the one being reduced, you're the one that is being oxidized. And since the reducing agent is the one that is causing the reduction, he is not the one who is being reduced. So that means that only means he can only be the one that's being oxidized. So it's something along that reasoning. So anyway, as I was saying here, so the further we go up, it's increasing strength as an oxidizing agent. The one we go down, that's increasing strength of a reducing agent. So that means in a reaction between, say, here we have lithium and, say, the one, let's say, sodium. Lithium and sodium, the one that acts as the reducing agent is the lithium. That means the one that's being oxidized. And the sodium is the one that acts as the oxidizing agent because it has a greater strength as an oxidizing agent. That means sodium is the one that's being reduced. Now, that is basically how you will know which one of them will be reduced or oxidized. Now, let's see another one. So how about I'm going to use sodium again. So sodium, this time, sodium and chromium. So between sodium and chromium, this time, sodium is the one has a greater strength of a reducing agent. So because here, increasing strength is a reducing agent. So sodium has a greater strength as a reducing agent. So in this case, between sodium and chromium, sodium is the one that's acting as the reducing agent. That means it's the one being oxidized. And your chromium is the one that's acting as the oxidizing agent. That means it's the one that's being reduced. So basically, that's how it goes, or how you read basically this table. So that is for standard reduction potentials. So we do not change E naughts, even if we have coefficients. So for example, so what will happen if the molecular bromine is added to a solution containing NaCl and NaI? So it's either chloride or iodide at 25. So if we look back at our table here, increasing strength as a reducing agent. So the E volts here, as you can see actually, without looking at the table, we can just look at their value. So as you can see here, the one with the greatest strength as a reducing agent, it has the most negative value, whereas the one that has the greatest strength as an oxidizing agent, it's the one with the most positive value. So looking at the values alone without looking at their positions in the table, so here, for example, for chlorine, you have your the standard reduction potential of chlorine is positive 1.36. For bromine, it's positive 1.07. And for iodine, you have 0.53. So in here, the most, the least number is basically your iodine. So between bromine and iodine, your reaction should be that bromine with oxidized iodine. So again, we have the more negative or the lowest number will be the one that will act as the reducing agent. And the highest number will be the one that's acting as the oxidizing agent. So bromine will be reduced by iodine. So bromine is the oxidizing agent between bromine and iodine, whereas bromine will be the reducing agent between bromine and chlorine. So basically, that's how you read it. So you will know which one will undergo oxidation and reduction. So since we say here, this one must be the reducing agent because it has the lowest electromotive force, that means it will be the one that's being oxidized. So we write the oxidation side as the iodine, and the partner will be the reduction. And then remember, oxidation is decreased loss of electrons. So in this reaction, we are going to flip this reaction the product becomes the reactant and the reactant becomes the product for the oxidation side. But the reduction side, we just write it as is. So basically, that's for knowing which of them will be reduced or oxidized. Now, let's have another example. So the galvanic cell consisting of a magnesium electrode in a 1 molar magnesium nitrate solution and a silver electrode in a 1 molar silver nitrate solution. So what's the standard EMF of this cell at 25 degrees Celsius? So this is at standard conditions because you have, again, 1 molar of each. So since there are no gases here, so it's always at 1 ATM. But anyway, it's no need to declare that it's 1 ATM. Now, if you look at the standard reduction potential, this is again from the table. So you're going to get the standard reduction potentials from the table. So silver to the reduction of silver is 0.80 volts, and the reduction of magnesium is negative 237. So that means the one that is being reduced, or the one that's acting as the reducing agent is your magnesium. So this one being oxidized, the one that's being reduced is your silver. So you write the oxidation. So we say that the magnesium is the reducing agent. So it's being oxidized. So for oxidation, it's the loss of electrons. So we're going to flip this reaction. So again, flipping the reaction, magnesium solid becomes your reactant, and this is your product. And then for the cathode, as is, since this is a reduction already, you just write it as is. So this is the reaction, the overall reaction, just add them together. So this is your reaction. Now, by the way, balance your electrons. So two electrons. So balance your electrons. And regardless of whether you multiply it by two, you are not so unlike in the enthalpy that you need to multiply the enthalpy with the coefficients. This case, you are not supposed to multiply anything to the electromotive forces. You're just going to add them or subtract them as needed. In this case, the silver, so cathode versus anode. The one in the cathode is the one that's being... The one in the cathode is the oxidizing agent. That's the one being reduced. So cathode is the one being reduced. So this is 0.80. So cathode minus the anode. This is the cathode and this is the anode. So if you write them, cathode versus minus the anode. The anode is negative 2.37. You get 3.17. Now, how do you know that you have done this correctly? That you have correctly identified which is the one being oxidized, which is the one being reduced? Is if you have an E cell that has a positive value. So, if your E cell becomes negative, that means you have done incorrectly, or you have mixed up your reducing agent and oxidizing agent. So basically, you have an error. So your reducing agent should not be the reducing agent, and your oxidizing agent should not be the oxidizing agent. That is if you have a negative E cell. So if you have a positive potential, that means you did correctly. Okay, so you have basically a forward reaction. Although that is not always the case. But anyway, if it's negative, if your E cell is negative, that means you have done correctly. Or rather, if you have an E cell that is negative, that means you have an error in your reaction. So it must always be positive. Okay, so let's move on to spontaneity. After in the next video.